Were you sitting in that cell thinking, I'm going to get out of here one day?
No, to answer your question honestly, I did not believe I would ever get out. And so what happened on August 1st, the only way I can describe that is a miracle.
The miracle was in the making for more than a year. Negotiations began over Americans held by Putin, which eventually included Evan Gershkovich, a reporter for the Wall Street Journal. But over the months, the deal grew to involve seven countries. At the center of the negotiations was Jake Sullivan, President Biden's national security advisor.
None of this happens overnight. None of it's straightforward. There's going to be twists and turns. There's going to be false starts. And so persistence, relentlessness, that's part of the name of the game of actually securing the release.
You've been wrongfully detained for a long time, and we're glad you're home.
With President Biden was Kara Mirza's family.
We're in the Oval Office.
You've done a wonderful thing by saving so many people. I think there are 16 of us on the plane. I don't think there are many things more important than saving human lives.
It felt surreal. It felt more emotional than I had ever felt at any point in my life.
There had been many emotions for Jake Sullivan, who for years could tell desperate families only to keep waiting.
And most of the time, as you can imagine, those are tough conversations. But not today. Today, excuse me. Today was a very good day.
Please welcome to introduce our keynote speaker, White House National Security Advisor, Jake Sullivan.
Good evening, everyone. It's a genuine honor to be here with you all, and I first want to thank Mike and Andy for bringing us all together tonight. I've been lucky enough to learn from a president who learned from great Greek-American leaders, many of whom are here tonight. And whenever President Biden talks about the Greek-American community, he always mentions two words, courage and character. Those same two words define Vladimir Kara-Mirza, who I'm deeply proud to introduce this evening. And Vladimir's family, his wife Evgenia, and his three kids, Katya, Sonia, and Daniil. It is just incredible to be here tonight to honor all of them for everything that they have done, everything they've been through, and everything they've contributed. And before I go on, I just want to say that I don't think I would be standing here tonight if it weren't for Diane Foley, who spoke a little bit earlier. I think she completely transformed the U.S. government's approach to prioritizing and relentlessly pursuing the release and return of hostages and unjustly detained Americans around the world. I think we should give her another round of applause for what she has done. Three months ago, as you just saw in that slightly embarrassing video clip, I stood at a podium like this and was able to tell the entire world that Vladimir and 15 other people detained in Russia were finally coming home. And our administration's priority since day one has been to be able to say those same words to every American family with a loved one unjustly detained abroad. And under President Biden's leadership, we've actually made historic progress. Over the last 4 years, we've secured the release of more than 70 of our fellow Americans from across the world, some who hadn't touched U.S. soil or seen their families for as long as 5 or 6 years. And as you heard me say in the video, this is hard work. There's a lot of twists and turns, a lot of false starts, a lot of hard conversations along the way. But when we get to see Americans come home, when we get to see people like Vladimir back home, when we get to see him sitting here tonight, then we can be reminded of the power of diplomacy, the power of strong allies and friends around the world, the power of hope. And it's a reminder of why we must never stop working to secure the release of wrongfully detained Americans or prisoners of conscience, wherever they are held, by whomever they are held, and wherever they come from. And that is a commitment that President Biden has instilled in every single one of us. And he's done it for one reason. It's because who we are, it is who we are as Americans. Prisoners of conscience include people like Vladimir Kara-Mirza. Just like the brave men and women of Greece 82 years ago, he has dedicated his life to saying, "Ohi, no." No to Putin's tyranny and injustice. No to the corruption and censorship and human rights abuses that Putin and his government perpetrate every day. No to Putin's vicious and wholly unjust war against Ukraine. And no to Putin's dark vision for the future of Russia. Instead, through activism and journalism, Vladimir has fought relentlessly for a better future for his children and for all children, one of democracy, of freedom, of justice, of accountability. His impact has been immense, but so has his sacrifice. He's been harassed, threatened, stalked, monitored, poisoned, not just once, but twice. One of those poisonings put him in a coma. He had to learn to walk again, to eat again, to speak again. But as soon as he regained his voice, he used it to keep saying no. After enduring all of that, Vladimir chose to return to Russia, to continue speaking out against Putin's regime, knowing he would almost certainly suffer that same fate again or worse. But you know what he said? How could I not go back? How could I not go back? To me, that is the essence of courage. That is the essence of Vladimir's courage, of his relentlessness, his fearlessness, his willingness to fight for change, and to do so again and again and again, no matter the cost. You see, for people like Vladimir, there's no alternative. There's no other option but to stand up against fear and violence and oppression, to never give up hope, that a better future can and will come if brave citizens raise their voices. Now, I want to make sure you actually hear his voice tonight. So let me close with this. 2 years ago, I actually stood right here at this podium. I was given the privilege and honor of introducing President Zelensky, who received an award on Ohi Day. Evgenia was here. But Vladimir was not. He was 5,000 miles away in a Russian prison. He had just been accused of treason for speaking out against Putin's vicious war against Ukraine, a sentence that, as he said in the video, carried the prospect of him dying in a Russian prison. That did not unnerve him. Instead, from his cell, he wrote an article about the need to keep advocating for a democratic Russia, about the need to keep building a whole, free, and peaceful Europe. And he said the following: "Even today, in the darkest of hours, I firmly believe that time will come. Vladimir, I believe that moment will come as well, and it will come because of people like you and the other people who are being honored tonight. And it has been a privilege to me to get to play a very small role among a very large team of dedicated public servants in the U.S. government who work tirelessly to help bring this about. And it's been just a true, genuine honor in a tough and turbulent time for me to be here with you tonight to introduce Vladimir Kara-Murza. Thank you very much."